Today, let's talk about insulin resistance and its relationship with type 2 diabetes. Before discussing insulin resistance, let's first understand what insulin is. It's a protein hormone secreted by the pancreas beta cells. When it effectively binds to insulin receptors on the surface of target cells, it triggers a series of biochemical events. You can think of this process simply as using a key to unlock a lock. Under normal conditions, if insulin is effective, it allows glucose in the blood to enter cells, increasing the cell's use of glucose. Thus, it is the only hormone in the body that can directly reduce blood sugar levels. Insulin also promotes the conversion of glucose into glycogen, stored as a backup energy source in the liver and muscles. Additionally, insulin promotes the synthesis of fatty acids and reduces fat breakdown, helping fat cells store excess energy. It also enhances protein synthesis and reduces protein breakdown, which is important for maintaining muscle mass and overall metabolic health. From this perspective, insulin has anabolic effects. Besides, insulin can regulate cell growth and division, helping to promote the body's growth, development, and tissue repair. Simply put, you can understand insulin's role in the body as reducing blood sugar levels. In scenarios where artificial insulin is not used, if the levels of insulin in the blood gradually increase, we typically observe that the body accumulates more fat due to insulin's energy storing action. If the insulin levels in the blood are very low or undetectable, the body's blood sugar levels can rise significantly. This usually indicates type 1 diabetes or severe pancreatic disease. Symptoms may include thirst, continuous drinking of water, frequent urination, extreme hunger, eating more, but losing weight. What is insulin resistance? Insulin resistance refers to conditions where the level of insulin is normal or elevated, but the biological response induced by insulin is diminished. Traditionally, this means that the cells that should work closely with insulin to reduce blood sugar are not as sensitive as before. They can neither effectively promote glucose entry into the cells nor effectively suppress the body's autonomous production of more glucose or fat breakdown. As a result, the body has to produce more insulin in an attempt to restore its normal function. More insulin leads to hyperinsulinemia, a driving factor of insulin resistance, which ultimately traps the body in a vicious cycle. How does insulin resistance occur? Insulin resistance occurs through specific mechanisms revealed in a 2018 paper, including a reduction in insulin receptors, meaning fewer proteins on the cell surface to bind insulin, and impaired insulin signal transduction, which means that the series of biochemical reactions that should occur after insulin binds to its receptor are not fully happening. What's the relationship between insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes? Let's first discuss the onset of type 2 diabetes. According to the 9th edition of Internal Medicine textbooks, the interpretation of type 2 diabetes begins with insulin resistance accompanied by progressively insufficient insulin secretion, shifting to primarily insufficient insulin secretion accompanied by insulin resistance. How should we understand this? In the early stages of type 2 diabetes, the body can still control blood sugar relatively well. At this time, insulin resistance is present, and insulin can still be secreted in large amounts, but over time, the amount of insulin secreted increasingly fails to meet demands. In the middle to late stages of type 2 diabetes, the body can no longer control blood sugar on its own, blood sugar levels rise significantly, and various complications appear. At this time, the pancreas can no longer produce enough insulin, but insulin resistance is still present. This shows that insulin resistance is a constant throughout the progression of typical type 2 diabetes. In other words, without insulin resistance, there would not be true type 2 diabetes. However, if we do not investigate the underlying causes of the disease, we could still be misled by conditions that appear to be type 2 diabetes. It might seem that just meeting the three factors of being an adult, obesity, and chronic high blood sugar could diagnose type 2 diabetes. But the reality is not that simple. If tests reveal clear immunological factors or genetic involvement, or diabetes caused by other diseases or drugs, these should be classified according to the textbooks as other types of diabetes. In a fast-paced clinical setting, most doctors might not delve into these details, and patients may fear the high costs. Additionally, many people might think that ultimately, isn't the problem always resolved with medication? If you truly believe that medication is the only solution for chronic diseases, then many chronic diseases will never escape the need for medication. In that case, there may be little point in continuing to focus on healthy lifestyles and nutritional therapy. Thus, insulin resistance is an issue that needs significant attention. If we can detect and predict insulin resistance in our bodies earlier, we can take earlier measures to adjust our lifestyles and diets. Generally, excessive subcutaneous fat, particularly ectopic fat like liver fat, is an important marker and contributing factor to insulin resistance. Everyone's body has subcutaneous fat, which is an energy reserve for the body, preventing excessive energy accumulation in the viscera and muscles. However, not everyone has the same capacity in their subcutaneous fat stores. When subcutaneous fat cells exceed their storage capacity and further expand, causing dysfunction, this leads to fatty acid spillover. Free fatty acids enter surrounding tissues, activating inflammatory pathways. Macrophages are recruited to clear the site, but this process produces pro-inflammatory cytokines, such as tumor necrosis factor alpha, TNF-alpha, and interleukin 6, IL-6. These inflammatory mediators cause local inflammation and can circulate to other organs like the liver via the bloodstream, causing oxidative stress in the liver and affecting the liver's insulin receptor levels and insulin signal transduction, increasing the risk of liver insulin resistance, impacting lipid metabolism, and promoting the formation of fatty liver. Over 40 years ago, people with fatty liver were typically alcoholics. But now, the majority of people with fatty liver are those who drink sugary beverages and eat large amounts of staples and junk food. If the liver accumulates too much fat, it cannot function well and needs the pancreas to produce more insulin to help it complete its tasks. Besides obese individuals, we can also see slim-looking people with non-alcoholic fatty liver who have insulin resistance. This highlights the central role of the liver in the process of insulin resistance. Because the liver is a hub for regulating blood sugar, fat, and energy metabolism in the body. So, please pay attention to and protect your liver. The second factor closely related to insulin resistance is stress, which is unrelated to energy or food. Stress drives insulin resistance through hormone-driven methods by increasing cortisol levels in the body, ultimately leading to insulin resistance. Although some people may lose weight, their visceral fat is increasing. This is similar to what you see in patients with Cushing's syndrome. Having discussed so much, since insulin is so important, why not simply make insulin measurement as routine as blood sugar testing? The main reason is that the methods and standards for testing insulin vary worldwide, affecting the reliability of the results. Another relatively minor reason is that insulin is more susceptible to dietary, weight, and physiological influences. Of course, when possible, combined with other metabolic tests, insulin can still be a good indicator for assessing insulin resistance. Ideally, fasting insulin should be between 2-10 mu/milliliter. Once it exceeds 15, it indicates likely significant insulin resistance. In such a state, losing weight can also be very difficult, as fasting insulin continuously prompts cells to store more energy. So how can insulin levels be reduced? There are four ways to achieve this: diet, exercise, medication, and surgery. The biggest impact on insulin in the diet comes from refined carbohydrates and sugars, which need to be strictly controlled if there is significant insulin resistance. However, whole grains and fiber-rich root vegetables are not a problem. Although they also contain starch, their conversion to sugar is relatively slow, and their stimulation of insulin is relatively low. Additionally, plant fiber is also beneficial for gut health and metabolic health. Amino acids can also raise insulin levels, especially branched-chain amino acids, which refer to leucine, isoleucine, and valine. But the body needs amino acids. So, if you don't have the goal of building muscle or heavy weight training, there's no need to take supplements rich in branched-chain amino acids. Excessive consumption of branched-chain amino acids could interfere with amino acid metabolic pathways, affect the liver's handling of other amino acids, and potentially disrupt normal fat metabolism, promoting fat accumulation in the liver. Also, in the absence of exercise, high levels of leucine can stimulate insulin secretion, aggravate insulin resistance, and promote the formation of fatty liver. As for fats, their impact on insulin is not as significant as sugars and amino acids. Of course, more effective methods lie in the mode of eating. Choosing to eat within a limited time frame gives the intestines enough rest time, allowing them to regenerate energy, produce stem cells, and help quickly reduce insulin levels. Although I support intermittent fasting because it truly helps some people with insulin resistance and fatty liver, it is not necessarily suitable for everyone. So, if you decide to implement such a method, make sure to do so with professional support. As for the role of exercise in improving insulin resistance, numerous studies have confirmed its effectiveness. Exercise itself can directly stimulate glucose in the blood to enter muscle cells, a process that does not depend on insulin. Regular exercise can also promote an increase in the number of insulin receptors on muscle cell membranes, enhance their function, and improve muscle cell responsiveness to insulin, helping to enhance overall body insulin sensitivity. Additionally, exercise reduces visceral fat, liver fat, bodily inflammation, and improves lipid metabolism. All these factors help improve insulin sensitivity. However, it is important to note that exercise should be appropriate for individual capabilities. What works for others may not necessarily work for you. Aerobic exercise is suitable for most people, such as cycling, walking, and practicing Tai Chi. This type of exercise is relatively easy, sustainable, does not significantly affect cortisol levels, and helps enhance insulin sensitivity. Higher doses of exercise may have more pronounced effects and improve insulin resistance issues. For example, high-intensity interval training, HIIT, and sprint interval training, SIT, require higher physical fitness and should also be conducted under professional guidance. If possible, a combination of the two types of exercise would be beneficial. In general, regardless of the type of exercise, do not exceed what your body can handle. Ensure sufficient sleep and rest, as well as nutritional support, to promote body recovery. Otherwise, continuous exercise could cause harm to the body, increase physical strain, raise inflammation levels, and continuously increase cortisol levels, which is not conducive to recovering from insulin resistance. As for medications that increase insulin sensitivity and weight loss surgery, these are not the first choices for improving insulin resistance. They should be treatment methods recommended by doctors based on your body condition when ordinary interventions are ineffective.